So after repository, there is a possibility. The next section was section number 5 or 6? 6, right? So 6 could be like FICO or FICO score information. So from all three repository or all three credit agencies or credit bureaus, they will be there. FICO scores will be written. If we feel, if we will be having two borrowers in the credit report, right? Then we will have 6 FICO score, and if we will have one borrower, we will have only 3 FICO scores, right? So it could be written, okay, Experian 680. Let's assume we have only one borrower. Then Equifax could be 690, and TransUnion could be 680 again. Okay. This is how, and there will be more paragraphs, but we just need to check these scores. Okay, that we discussed all about the scores, so I don't want to discuss again. And then there could be fraud alerts could be related to SSN number. Okay, there could be two type of SSN, like our borrower SSN might have been used by someone else and our borrower could be a victim, or you know, was a victim in that suspicious activity. I mean, someone used our borrower's SSN number, right? However, maybe he didn't become the victim because there was some kind of setting up in the credit report that there was no misuse. I mean, the SSN was not misused, but there is a possibility it could be misused, right? But it could have been misused in the past. So those kind of SSN alert, we always need to see whatever the detail written in here, and according to that we should proceed. Like if there is an SSN alert appearing that, you know, this SSN has been misused in the past. So as per the alert, their borrower may have provided a phone number. Whenever you receive this credit report for a loan purpose, please call on this number and get verified whether I applied or someone else applied. So if that is the case, then someone from the processing team, there will be condition will be added by the underwriter that verification need to be done according to the fraud alert appearing in the credit report. Here is a number. Someone from the processing department, they are going to call on that number and going to confirm whether borrower applied for the loan or someone is again trying to misuse the SSN or the information of borrower. Okay, those kind of SSN. And there could be there is a possibility that this person belongs to this SSN, was involved in the past in some suspicious activity. In that case, we again need to do some more research with different reports and need to take the actions, appropriate actions. And then it could be borrower name, right, or address could be that address that has been on the, maybe there are different address, right? There could be one address that borrower is going to purchase. That address in the past somebody misused. So now we are going to purchase that property. So we are good. Someone else, it was not our borrower's property. Someone else misused that property when it was not. Now our borrower is going to purchase that property. But if it's a refinance, borrower is going to refinance that property and that property was misused or was involved in some kind of suspicious activity, then obviously we have to be extra careful, and according to the guideline we need to proceed, or we need to dig out the different information and need to make sure or justify that alert does not make any negative impact or create any negative impact to the marketability of that property, or does not make any negative impact to our loan. So there is a lot of information that could be done. There is a lot of information that need to be checked or could be checked and justified. Okay, SSN alert, then there could be OFAC. OFAC. What is OFAC? Is like some, you know, it's a kind of foreign office of foreign affairs. Like, you know, if someone's, there is a, let's say it's a gray list or it's a black list, that people who are involved in some foreign, you know, foreign countries or with anyone of any, you know, their name reflects in that blacklisted countries, they visited those countries, or there could be different number of regions, but there is an OFAC list that is available online. If any of the borrower name, last name match in that OFAC list, then we need to do some extra research again. We need to go to that OFAC list and need to check that the name appearing in that OFAC list is not belongs to our borrower. But there could be, like, you know, sometimes last name, first name, or even then, you know, could some information could match. But yes, we can easily go to the data verify report or some other drive report or some other report, and we can easily verify that, okay, whether that alert is relates to our borrower or not, right? Okay, so those kind of alerts, those are going to appear, and there are more alerts as well related to hotel address, like previous the property which borrower is refinancing or purchasing that was used previously as hotel or motel, you know, those kind of alerts could also appear. Okay, then fraud alert number 8. What else we need to check after fraud alerts? It could be public record. Public record. What are public records? Public records are any judgment against borrower, right? Or it could be bankruptcy. There was any bankruptcy or fight by borrower, or there could be a foreclosure. Any foreclosure, right? Or any kind of lien, right? Lien judgment, tax lien, anything that is, you know, on the public records, that is available on the public record, that is going to appear here. And whenever it appears here, according to the guidelines, there are different credit guidelines. We might, you know, whenever we will proceed with the underwriting training, obviously you will get to know that time what are these, right? Or maybe in the further sessions coming up, the new sessions, we will, we might review everything, all the terms and conditions, what are these, how to satisfy or how to justify all these things, right? What need to be checked. But these are the records that are going to appear in the public record, okay? And then after public record, it could be like, you know, credit report summary. Now what the summary is? This summary is going to tell us about how many trade lines borrower has, how many accounts borrower has, and how many of them are active, how many of them have the actual balance collectively, what is the total balance they owe, right? And what is the total monthly payment for different type of account that we are going to see. So it's a summarized table or section that will be given to us. Okay. By going through that, we can easily check how many trend lines they have, how many different accounts they have, and what is their total balance there that need to be paid, what is the total monthly payment they are currently paying. Okay, and how many of the trend lines those have already been closed. So that is the summary report. So take public record, fraud alerts, FICO scores, credit report, and then the credit inquiries. Credit inquiries, we have already discussed so much about the credit inquiries, how it happened, why it happened. Most of the lenders, they always need to check last 120 days. Last 120 days of the inquiry that borrower did. Now, what is the purpose behind these credit inquiries? We will always be sending a credit inquiry letter, whatever the inquiry borrower did in the last 120 days, and borrower need to confirm what happens actually whenever the credit, as I told you, three bureaus, they are collating all the data of the credit history, or whatever the credit transaction inquiries borrower is currently doing or did, right? But it is not, most of the time, it is not that same day it will be appearing in the in the credit report. Let's say somebody inquired today and after 1 month or 1.5 month, that loan was actually financed. Right? I inquired for a loan today. So obviously within few days, that inquiry will appear in my credit report. But that loan I am not taking, I could not, there is a possibility that that loan was not funded to me on that day, not even a week, but after 1 month. So obviously the credit inquiry is going to appear in the credit report, but that loan will not be updated because it takes at least 45 days minimum to any information to appear on the credit report, right? That is why we almost go for 4 months of the credit inquiry. This is what we believe, that at least any inquiry done, if they are going to, if they will be financing, against that inquiry, then that new financing, whatever their balance and payment, that is monthly payment, that is going to appear in the credit report at least after 45 days, right? Okay, so that those are the 120 days. For the last 120 days inquiries, we always need the explanation from borrower whether any new debt opened or not. Okay, and if new debt opened, that need to be considered for the loan qualification. That expense need to be added into the borrower monthly expenses. Great, good. Is there anything else? These are the most of checks that needed to be done, and then we will the next thing could be the trade lines or accounts information. Trade line or say account information, different accounts, how many accounts borrower will have, or borrower is active or deactive or inactive or closed. Are we good till this point? Everyone is clear with all these terms?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it's just a basic information of the credit report. We are not discussing all detail what are actually these terms and how to satisfy these terms, how to clear any alert, how to what happens if address doesn't match with the current address or the previous address is different. Sometimes it could be like borrower saying I'm living at the current address for 3 years, but when we pull the credit report is giving us different address that has been reported in the credit report by borrower at different times in the last 2 years. Then that is a questionable item, right? He borrower is living in the current address for 3 years. Then how he or she can report different address, in the for the credit bureaus? I mean, how that those get? Let's take an example. Maybe I'm living right now in one place, right, and that is my current address. But I'm at some other place. I just inquired about some product. And when they asked me, okay, what is your current address? And I gave them some different address. Obviously, that is going to appear there. That okay, this person did an inquiry on at such place, and the address was reported this. I mean, the current address I supplied there, that was different. So that means I may have other property as well, which I'm not disclosing here. So it can lead to any information, right? But all those research and dig outs are related to credit underwriting. We are not going to discuss that because we are just going through the basic information in the credit report. Okay. So that was the number 11. That was trade line, right? Trade line info. Now what do we mean by trade line? There are different accounts borrower has, and those accounts when they open, right, when they what was the last reported to the bureau date, right, and what is their current balance, what was their limit, right, all that information is going to appear line by line per account. Right, so how that is going to appear? Let me give you an example. So let's say borrower has one credit card, right, with the Wells Fargo. So who is the creditor? credit could be American Express, let's say American Express, right? That is the credit card borrowed, right?